Seek your balance. What do you have, sis?
Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for being patient. Thank you for being patient.
Oh, no problem. And congratulations to the brother for discharging those debts. Where I'm kind of going with this is some type of overall remedy, maybe. Like, I've recently learned about this Nubian account deal with the Social Security office, where you can get the records of every time your Social Security number was used in a transaction. Because, like I was saying the other day about kind of correcting everything after it's happened, it seems like, you know, it kind of becomes a hassle, and not necessarily like what I'm saying for me in particular, but it seems like a lot of people are not competent to handle these issues, which I'm not saying, oh, let's go and try and save all the people, which I literally probably am trying to do, but from another aspect. But it just seems like it's so much entailed in all of this. And at some point, is there a remedy that is not all encompassing, but like, it you know, it kind of goes around and around. And then like the end goal would be to have good credit and open businesses to do things for society that haven't been done. So, you know, discharging the debt is one thing, but then moving forward, you know, are we going forward into doing things that do benefit the people as a whole, or, you know, is it kind of an individual basis, or, you know, what do you think about that concept?
Is that question directed to me?
Well, probably at everybody, because once these things take place, then like the brother just said, you know, what do you look to go forward from here? And, you know, purchasing a home, because that is really important. And if we look around, we see these tent cities being put up all across the country. But I'm sitting here, I've been this morning watching this impeachment of Biden deal, and I'm just watching how much money they're talking about goes across the tables. And we're clearly looking at treason. So whatever they've got going on is one thing, but the people that suffered as a result of the actions of these people that we're watching in power, so to speak, the people are homeless. And then those accounts that they are saying they funnel money into, okay, they're either just left to, you know, keep the money, or, you know, they take it, or the people go to jail or whatever. But what about those people that are now homeless because of that? And then at the same time, there's no money. So the transactions should have been a part of the appropriations for the budget that they do every year, that every state actually receives money for. So even the child support is not something that should even be charged. So, you know, I guess maybe I'm asking, how do we go about correcting these wrongs overall? Because it just seems like it's so much. I don't know.
Okay, so how long have you actually, because I actually, I've seen you on here before, at least in the comments. How long have you actually listened to Tazadaq?
Well, I'm the same lady that asked you, do you remember me writing the foreword to your book? And about my son, which he says now he remembers. She's like, yeah, I remember him. And it, like, we literally talked for a long time. And some of the things that we talked about are really important too.
Okay, how long have you you haven't been watching it consistently, right? Because the reason that I'm raising that question is because if you've been watching the channel, the guy Tazadaq has actually been trying to encourage all the people around him to repair their credit, get his books, repair their credit, and build a community.
Okay.
He's been pulling teeth to try and get these. In fact, he was just having this conversation right now about the debtors. He's literally talking about the people first that's around him that call themselves T-Doc. Everybody allegedly is working on their purpose, but how long are you going to work on your purpose without being productive and showing anything, or that you even have any type of purpose at all? So that guy Tazadaq's literally been trying to pull teeth to get these guys to, hey, let's fix your credit. If you don't have the fiat, you don't need the fiat. All you need is some credit. You get the credit. We all, you know, so everyone don't actually have to take out too big of a loan. You get the credit. You we invest into some land. We start doing some crops. Then we get some real estate to put on the land and, you know, get some commercial property. And, you know, just kind of like produce for yourselves. But it's really exceedingly difficult for someone that's actually been suffering from cognitive dissonance for so many years to fathom that to be possible. I mean, they just can't fathom into their mind that, hey, I've been a loser all of my life. Do I really have the capacity to do this? They just cannot, I guess, push their mental faculty into a position where they can see themselves being successful and producing for themselves. This is where you got people going around right now in our communities teaching people about consumer credit without understanding words. You know, they understand words from colloquial speech and common parlance, but they don't understand the language that these people are speaking them in it, to them in. So they say a consumer is a debtor. Why would I want to be a consumer? Why do I not want to be the person that's producing it? Because if I'm a consumer, then I'm using something that someone else is producing. That's very simplistic to understand. So why would I want to be a consumer? That means I'm going to always have to go to someone else. And what if they decide to elevate the prices or decide they may not even want to do business with me anymore? Now what? And so that's the predicament we've been in.
How do you feel about the system overall and the way it operates? Like, in terms of, like you were saying, getting our own property and raising our own vegetables or crops or whatever. Like, I think maybe two live streams ago, I mentioned in the comments that I wanted to speak with you about a concept that I have for living.
You was on here?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
The little lady was there, and she was in Texas, I think, and you all were talking to her at the end about feminist. You said, I think, something about a feminist or something like that, and then she came onto the live stream. That's the one I was talking about.
Oh, yeah, that's probably about 5 ago.
Okay, well, I think in the comments I mentioned to you about this concept.
I don't really read the comments a lot, sis. The moderator, you're supposed to read them. I really pay attention to the comments.
You may have responded, but I don't know if it was necessarily to that comment that I was writing, but you did say, okay, secret. But what I was considering is, like, the environment that we live in is actually a natural environment that produces everything that we need to live. So atmospheric precipitation produces water that, just like the dew on the side of your cup or your can when you're drinking, produces that dew, or the dew in the yard in the morning, is produced in the atmosphere. So we don't need their water, which is actually not good, because they got a whole system where actually you get the water back that you just put out, which is a whole nother thing. But the atmospheric electricity, so we don't need their electricity. And then if we have our own property and we're building our own buildings using 3D printers, we don't need the manpower, so there's not a big overhead cost. And then the concept of creating the software to actually produce the, you know, whatever you're wanting, how you want your house to look, whatever. And then using permaculture to use that water to go through the house or the property and then to the black water and gray water system and then out to a creek that keeps funneling the water back. So then you're actually using and preserving your own water system. And it's not something that's difficult to understand or actually to do, especially with, you know, the 3D printing and things like that. So what I think I'm asking is, like, maybe, you know, some of these concepts, like I have a million concepts, but that's because I'm a student of all disciplines. So that's probably why I hadn't been just consistently watching. But like, it seems like there's so many things that could be solved with simple ideology or simple concepts, but they're not kind of expressed or pushed, you know, on a large enough scale. So maybe that's where some of it lies with the people. And then like narcissistic personality disorder has these people not living in reality. And that's kind of why this cognitive dissonance sets in, because they're like, well, forget it. And then they just go back to work and they keep working to get paid out of their own trust account. And, you know, then half of them don't know about it. So that's a whole nother thing. And then we got billions of people on the planet, but everybody is operating out of this system in the United States, not just the people that are here in the United States. So that's another thing. So it's like, it's like so much corruption and deception everywhere. And it's beyond control, literally.
Yeah. Marty, you have something, brother? You need to bring some more people in here from England. Marty, they know Kahan tells a doc in England. Bring some more people on here, Mike. He just fell out and made him run.
And I appreciate your platform for being a place to speak to some of these issues, because, you know, debt is one side of it. But, you know, like the brother was saying, Universe Soul was saying, you know, where do we go from here? So, you know, with the people that you do develop a team with, then you're able to speak to some of these larger issues, and then implementing, you know, concepts like what I was just speaking about.
Okay, let me interject for a second, sis. So, because I don't think you're hearing me. There's people that's been around that guy Tazadaq 5 years, 7 years, 7.5 years, still debtors, still have excuses as to why, you know, they're not productive. So the product model that Kahan tells the doc try to give them is that everyone go out and bring in more people, right? Everyone go out. It shouldn't always be people are coming around simply because Kahan tells the doc, if it's supposed to be a body, right? It's supposed to be everyone that's bringing in someone, right? So you can ask any of the other people, how many people have they actually been, or have they brought into the fold since they've been around? And the answer would be zero. It would be zero, right? So primarily people just come around because, you know, generally they want something from that guy, Tazadaq, or, you know, they'll come in pretending in to be interested and, you know, the Bible, but ultimately the objective is generally commerce. But they try to clothe that in lies, you know, of the Bible or something like that. But if it's only Tazadaq that's doing all of this stuff, then it should only be him to reap the benefits. So the things that he's talking about, he could probably do that on his own. But a team is always better than one head. It's always better. It can always be more productive. But when you're talking to people and they're kind of like mules, jackasses, that, you know, they're stubborn. You got to, you know, stay on them. Like, you know, people think I'm rude, but when they meet me in person, they be like, damn, you ain't nothing like the internet personality. But I have to light a fire into some of these people's asses to try and get them to move. But then what happens, they don't keep fuel on the fire. They get around their family members and certain associates, and the fire goes out. So they go right back in the debtor mode. So year after year, if you look at the people that's been around for a few years, they're still where they once were. Nothing. I mean,
on the hamster wheel.
Not one of these guys could come around and give a testimony that they discharge, you know, even a $5,000 debt. I'm talking about the people that immediately be around Tazadaq. Can't go in and say that, hey, I've been successful with court. Right. And so, and you know what's crazy is they've seen testimony at the testimony with Tazadaq doing it himself at the inception. Then they've seen people coming up that's not even around them. case in point, I'll use Eric as a catalyst. Well, the guy's trying to discharge, not really discharge, he's trying to use a debt validation letter that Crystal used to get the title to a conveyance. Well, he does it, he does everything wrong. He's taking it as something small. I said, well, this is not going to work because you're not following the steps. People want to make up their own rules. When people start, why would you change something that's working? So I tell him, well, you got to get this, notary fell out the proof of service. What does he do? He get his wife to mail it. A notary doesn't even send it. So he comes back around me, still got the proof of service.
Uh-oh.
I said, well, let me see your file. Oh, you're telling me I sent it. Yeah, my wife mailed. I said, yo, you were supposed to have a third party mail that for a witness. Okay, well, where's the proof of service form? Oh, it's right here. Still blank. Then on top of that, he sent it to the wrong location. He didn't send it to the chief financial officer. Know where he sent it? He sent it to the place where they make payments. So Tazadaq told him, hey, if I was you, I can't tell you what to do. If I was you, I would make sure it's within a locked gate until I receive the discharge letter. But you're going to have to, kind of like redo what you've done because you didn't do it right. So he put the vehicle in a gate. And I guess with some people, you have to be extremely clarifying. Because he went and parked the vehicle in a housing area where anyone that drives up to the gate opens. So it wasn't in his gate on some private property. So the tow truck company went in and took the conveyance. But what's really interesting that he didn't get is that they gave it back to him. He went to the tow place. They gave him the conveyance back. And I told him the procedure probably worked. And then he told me he had received some notice or something. And the balance or something was zeroed out. And I told him, hey, you were supposed to take that and go to the DMV. But I don't know, man. If you can't figure this out on your own, some things, then this is not for you. This is not for everyone. But that's a prime example. And now they gave him the car back. And now they're like 5-6 payments behind. So guess what? They're going to try and come and get the car again. So I was like, yo, Eric, I have a seminar. Come to the seminar. One in Cleveland. I won't make this one, Tyler. I'll make the next one. Okay, so yeah, I'm doing one in D.C. Eric, you coming? He's just grunting like he's constipated or something. Like, he don't tell me. He tell you who should be. I think I might just show support. I don't know if I'm going to show up at this one. So that's what I mean about debtors for life. You can't help someone that doesn't want to help themselves. I can't drag him there. But I know that the answer to what he needs would be in the seminar. Because he can't read the book and get it on his own. So it needs to be deciphered and broken down to him. He needs to be asked questions like, what is it that you're not getting? But he doesn't want to show up, so I can't make him do it.
The underlying issue may be a spiritual one, because in our spiritual nature, we get it and we hear it. And then when it comes to this physical experience that we're having, there's so many obstacles and oppositions. So a little of it is understanding, but like the way people were taught in school doesn't really allow them to think critically, to be able to decipher, like you were saying yesterday about us being specific numbers in the case and then the debtor being specific numbers. I mean, like, that was so clear to me. I was like, wow, I wrote it down for the kids, and we talked about it yesterday. So some of it is able to be broken down in a simple way. But this education system that we've been a part of, which really should be dismantled, is like at the heart of why even the debt exists for college, like for people to even have to go and seek remedy for that or discharge that. So that's why I was saying, do you think the system itself actually like, what do you think about the system overall? Because, like I said, I'm looking at this situation here with this Biden impeachment deal, and they sure funnel a lot of money around. And when it comes
you're saying Biden, they're trying to impeach Biden?
Yes, they have a congressional
for what
meeting, I guess. They're saying for the money that Hunter Biden and Jill Biden, and that how they're transferring the money, and then it comes to Biden's account. But it seems like on both sides of the aisle, they're either trying to support, you know, get everybody to foster support behind their candidate. But it looks like all of them are really incompetent, because they're sitting here. It's kind of like a show, really. And I'm not watching it because I'm just so interested. I'm watching it for a particular reason, because I'm trying to see the mindsets of these people who sit here. And of course, everybody's income level is not the same, but you see different people speaking to different aspects of it. And some people, you can tell clearly the money part, they don't really care about. They just want to embarrass the other person. And at the end of the day, there are a lot of people that are homeless and starving right now all around the world, and especially here in the United States, while money is funneled to Ukraine and money is funneled here and there. And then they're trying to keep it out of people's hands.
We live in capitalism, so you don't always have at least 5% of the people that's going to be in those particular paradigms under capitalism. The next thing is that what part of the responsibility of these homeless people are they willing to assume? You see, the enemy is the enemy. I don't, you know, so as long as we keep trying to shift the blame to someone, then we're never going to have any remedy. There's a lot of people out there doing that. Now, the system, I like the system. I like the system because I learned to understand it. Do I agree with everything in it? No. But they've designed a beautiful system that if you're a creditor, you may learn to like it. I don't like how they're running, you know, I don't like if they use women. They're using women to conquer the patriots that still remain. See, there's two forms of patriot in society. There's those that work for Satan, and there's those that work for the Most High. The patriots that work for the Most High, the entire system is against, and so is the woman. See, they've turned the woman against the men, and she doesn't realize that she's only being used as a liaison to bring down the righteous patriots. Why? A prime example of a rebellious woman, and a woman that is rebellious won't receive this. She'll take this as offensive, is a woman that's not feminine and submissive. She wants to be a woman of Satan. You see, Satan just don't have evil, patriarchal males. He also have evil women that's toxic. See, no one talks about toxic femininity, but that's destroying the world. But it's not by their own accord. There's evil, patriarchal men behind that. Because where does women's rights come from? They come from patriarchal men that decided, well, we're going to give these to the women. Oh, we're going to give them this. We're going to take away this man's children, his seeds, and we're going to give it to the woman. And we're going to tell him, you've got to pay her child support. Right? So that's evil, patriarchal. But women don't complain about that on that side, because she believes is doing something that's helping her out. But when you really look at it, it's not. It's detrimental. Because Tazadaq was just talking the other day, by 2030, which is less than 6 years, 45% of females are going to be single and childless. No children. And they're not going to, most don't know how to raise them now. Most don't know how to be wives now. But that's what happens when evil, patriarchal men rule. And, you know, you take a woman and you turn her into something masculine. And so she's challenging the man, but she's not challenging the correct man. Because Satan is behind that entire paradigm right there. So when women is loud, masculine, that's not even in her nature. See, when women begin to really understand that, the etymology of words, just using the term, well, yeah, I could be a little masculine, that applies to a man in general. So that means you're now conducting yourself against your own nature. You know, masculine is a male tendency. Dominance is a male tendency. But now women are taking that on, and the social engineers are teaching you all this is normal. So they're trying to normalize it. And so women don't see any fault in it. So the people that deal with, you know, mind control, because you're talking about the world, right? They know that if they could tap into a woman's emotions, they could control her. See, I've been on this earth long enough that I know that if I tell a woman that she's attractive and I love her and I haven't tapped into her emotions, that means nothing. If a man just walking down the street says to a woman, oh, you're very beautiful, that means nothing. If a man that is a total stranger sends a woman a gift, that means nothing to her. She may consider him a weirdo. But if I tap into her emotions, if I could first get her emotionally involved, now that I love you carries a big, powerful effect on her. Those flowers now has a tremendous impact because now it's laced in with the emotions. And so the people that study the psychological engineering, they know this. So they tap into her emotions. They get her emotionally involved. Oh, you've been oppressed, you're being this, and yeah, you should be equal. Now her emotions are involved. She can't hear anything, huh? Because she's under Satan's authority. That's the part of the system that I dislike, because the system is using the woman against the good patriarchal men. And let's face it, the Most High is a patriarch. He's a patriarch. This is why, and can you prove that? Because he's always referring to himself as a him, he, him. Never her. But people want to come in and say, well, what about her? He never refers to himself as that. He's patriotical, which is why he gave man dominion over everything and made men stronger, more dominant. He took a man and a woman the same height and weight. In a physical battle, the man's going to win every time. No weapons or nothing. The man's going to win every time unless he has some sort of illness, because men are just designed naturally with 30% more muscle mass than women, just from their natural makeup. And the Most High designed it that way for a reason. Men were designed to be producers with more than one woman. Women don't accept that. They don't accept, they want to possess him. They want to change his nature. They want to say, if he could do it, I could do it too, but she really can't. See, that's the dumbing down of society. They've dumbed Eve down, and she thinks that she could do that. So she's accepting all this DNA, and she's not designed mentally or physically to deal with more than one man at once. And this is why the women that do, they seem bugged out of their minds, because they got all these spirits on them. It's not in their capacity to do that. A woman cannot raise more than one family at once. She can't do it. But a man could go to his family over here, his family over there, and be good to all of them. So these are things that society pushes against, but it's the truth. And no one wants to deal with it. But it's the truth. A man could do that. A man could be a good father to a family here, a family there, a wife there, a wife. You know what? She doesn't want to, her emotions. That's a part of Satan. That's a part of Satan, because why? Satan is going against the righteous patriarch that the Most High has established in this earth. Satan wants to destroy that. And what better tool has he used than Eve to do it? That was from the beginning. She made a covenant with Satan.
Well, I contend that the the struggle or the battle happens internally first with the divine masculine and divine feminine in all of us. So I do see what you mean when it comes to the experience that we have here in the physical. But my grandmother used to say the man is the maintainer, provider, and protector. And it makes a lot of sense. And my thoughts on the concepts of the relationship of between the man and the woman has evolved since 7 years ago when I spoke with you. And I was telling you then, which I think maybe you considered that I was maybe a little more masculine then, because you were saying like, you said something like, why are your shoulders so wide or something? And like, it's a whole thing that is, you know, it's something there that needs to be researched, because it seems like the spiritual connection that we have to the source is kind of thwarted for this physical experience. And we forget that it took those two energies coming together to create one single person in the physical. And we all did this together before, as you know, to create a mental body of God before the physical body was able to be manifested. So it seems like a lot of things are being kind of brushed over for this physical experience, and the spiritual experience is going to continue after we leave.
So stop for a second. You say we did this together to create a mental body of, I believe the term that you use was God.
Okay.
So elaborate on that, because it seems like that's something I utterly disagree with.
Okay. In the beginning, there was nothing. And then I guess they're calling it a big bang, but the merging of the divine masculine and divine feminine, which exist in all of us.
Okay, so now prove together. That. Prove that.
Okay, well, when we look at the tree of life, we see the masculine and the feminine.
No. Oh, hold on.
Pillars.
You said that there was nothing. You said
that there was nothing.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then what did you say happened?
A combination of the divine masculine and feminine, which is what the womb of life comes from. Like this whole, like, can you tell me where you think everything started or came from?
No, because at one point we were not. We're dealing with what you're saying right here, right now. Don't divert. You're saying some womb of life, and I would like you to, so you said that there was nothing, right?
Mm-hmm, the primordial water.
What? Well, water is something. Water takes up space, and it's matter. So water is something.
And that's what makes us matter. That's why this whole topic really matters so much to even Christians.
You say that there was nothing.
Yes, there was nothing.
So that means there had to be no water also then.
Well, let me not say nothing. There was no thing. Because nothing and no thing is two different things.
Water is a thing.
The primordial water.
What philosophy would you be pulling from to make these particular statements? What philosophy is it coming from? What school of thought?
For me, it's my internal natures or my mental body that says to me that at one, like I know before I was born, I was nothing. I mean, there was nothing. I was nothing. I didn't know anything. And then after I was born, of course, everything started. And then up until I can remember back now, there was an experience that I was having that I was, I guess, subconsciously unaware of, but still occurring and impacting me as a person or being in the physical. And then relative to what I know back now, from now back to that point, then that's the memory that I have. But when it doesn't serve us well, we tend to forget that before any of us were, we weren't. And then at some point we were. So what happens in between that? Because that happened to everybody and everything, and it's been continuing to happen on an evolutionary basis since the beginning of time. And I mean, that's just kind of an infinite regress argument, but that's not really particularly helpful in any situation.
So would it be fair to say that this is something that you basically created in your own mind?
Relative to the work that's out here by a lot of scholars that are so-called scholars, I guess you could say, in science.
When I was asking what philosophy you're pulling from, as opposed to reference and philosophy, you basically was, well, from what I took, was that you were, you, this is what you're creating from your inception of birth to where you are in life now. So accumulation of your life experiences, not based on a particular philosophy. So let's say
not based on a particular philosophy. Right, but so we can go Christian, through philosophy, right? With Plato and Socrates and all those people.
Let's say if he was a Muslim, right? And I was asking you where you're getting that from. A Muslim would tell me to get it from the Quran, or they're getting it from the surah, or some surahs or whatever, or some hadith, excuse me. And so that would be the basis of them, you know, coming to the, you know, conclusion where they are. So, you know, it's like when I'm trying to really understand when I'm talking to a person about, you know, their belief or whatever, I'm trying to really grasp on whether or not they have a concept on, or where does their concept of God come from? Are they speaking from a biblical perspective, like from the Bible? Are they speaking from a Hebrew perspective? Are they speaking from a Muslim's perspective, or a East Indian perspective, or maybe even Native American, where they have their you know, signs of life? So it will give me a basis of where I can, where we can have a, we can find some mutual and common ground. But when someone is basically going off their own creation of life, it's hard to actually find that common ground, because these are people that may be considered skeptics, because, you know, they basically skip around. They could just jump here and jump there, where they have no real foundation. So it can actually change. Their belief can actually change at the moment of conversation. Like before we had the conversation, they may have believed one thing, but as we're talking, then the belief has dramatically changed. So it's not really productive to really have that. Well, I'm not saying, well, for me, to be able to, I don't see the productivity of having a conversation where we can't find a common ground to agree on. So it's kind of like,
do you experience the nurturing essence when you deal with your children or love your mother? And then do you experience that that masculine protection energy or nature when you're protecting your mother and your children? It's the same concept. You know, it's the masculine and feminine that's within us all. Like your ability to nurture and love your wife and protect and maintain a household or environment for your family is the same concept. And it's not me pulling from a particular philosophy. It's me going inside in my internal self, inside of myself, and understanding these things.
I've got a few questions.
Let him finish. Go ahead.
When Kahan was asking you about, you know, something you stated, right? And when you stated it, he tried to garner a better understanding of it. You're at the moment, your system of belief changed. You at one point said that there was a nothing existence, a state of existence as nothing, but yet there was also called the primordial waters. And then when he was given the science breakdown of what you were saying, it brought light to the fact that there was, even in your concept of nothingness, that there was something there, which is basically like a sense of, I wouldn't say confusion. Like this even though you may believe that there's nothing there, but even in your own belief, there is basically a sense of fallacy, because there is still something there, which you would call the waters.
That's why I made reference to no thing and nothing being two different concepts right there.
Well, I'm kind of familiar with the concept of no thing and something. And in reality, it goes back to what's called, if I'm correct, it's called ought and not. So what ought to be done, what not to be done, or something or no, going from spelling it N-O being, and then a dot right there standing for a number, and then thing, T-H-I-N-G, or something spelled either S-O-M-E-T-H-I-N-G or S-U-M, going in with the numerical value, trying to say summing up to a thing, and then going back into the science of the equation, talking about hydrogen 1, hydrogen 2, doing a mathematical thing. So I'm following you there in concept. That's why I was trying to grasp where your philosophy was coming from, because although you may say that, your breakdown in philosophy contradicts that, because you're nothing, meaning that there is no, not necessarily numerical value, but there is no what we call matter. So matter comes into existence through ether, hydrogen, and so forth. So then we say nothing existed or no thing existed because there was no mathematical formula. There was nothing there that summed up to a thing, as opposed to when you got something into existence. So, but your philosophy in your own mind stating that there was a nothing, yet there were still primordial waters, in itself is a contradiction. Not to try to shame or anything, but try to just show where it's going to be, it's really kind of hard to have these kind of conversations when from my view, the perspective that you give out is somewhat contradictory. Not that you're trying to be trying to create controversy or be contradictory at all, but the fact that, you know, your belief is not really founded in something substantiated. It's not, it has no solid foundation. So that's why it's called, go ahead, I apologize, go ahead.
No, I'm sorry. I did want to make one reference here. According to my brother, who's a real life angel, his name is Dolo. Now, according to him, it's the concept that we're seeing of as God is a concept of all possibilities, where everything exists, but nothing exists. So there's no shape, no form, no color. All of these things that we're seeing now were created after, once this mental body, because we had to create the mind first before we could manifest this physical body. So these things are references that that wouldn't be in your average school book. And that's why I said the schools, we need to really reconsider what we're teaching everybody, because a lot of these schools of thought are based in concepts that came after everything was here. And if a man wrote it, then he's just like you and I, and he came from the same place that you and I come from. And I know I came from between the legs of a woman, which any living being or the essence of what we're calling a human being would have had to do. So it doesn't lend some importance to women, because that wouldn't be necessary. I mean, wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for her. And then Kahan did say something one day that really made a lot of sense to me. A man can make more than one child a year, and a woman can only make one. So that did change my whole idea and concept of what it meant to for one man to have multiple wives. So, I mean, I'm learning. I'm in this physical experience with you all, and I do think it's important that we have these conversations, because it does get to some relative perspectives that we all need to consider outside of what we've known from the regular schools of thought that we have. So I thank you for what you had to say.
Hey, look, real fast, y'all. Hey, look, hold on. So in so many words,
we lost your brother just that quick, as soon as you started talking. Hey, Kai, you on mute. Hey, can you guys hear me?
Tazadaq, we can't hear you.
So, we can hear you. We can hear you. So, it seems like, sis, what you're trying to push here is androgyny. And androgyny is a method that Satan uses, right?
No, not androgyny.
No, let me finish. Because I'm listening to what you're saying. Because Universal is right. When I put you on this side, because you said that there was nothing, and then when I showed you that why there was something, then you tap dance around it, and then you started going on another point. And so this is what Satan does, right? Satan uses androgyny to attempt to conquer all, right? And so the androgyny is that he tried to emphasize the equality of both sexes. And that's what you're trying to do. And now, with your last statement, you're trying to make it seem... Oh, let me finish. You're trying to make it seem as though I'm saying women are not important. We're not saying that at all. We never said that. See, hold on. Let me finish. Because that's the stance that women take when we say something that they're not in agreement with. They, instead of listening to the rationale in it, they take it as an attack on women. But the fact of the matter is, the Most High is a man, and he created man, right? So to govern everything, right? Now, I challenge all of these women that say otherwise to show me any civilization, unless it was mythological, that was ran by women. Show me when the world was dominated by women. You see, it's that way for a reason. Men's been ruling since the beginning of time for a reason, because he was given dominion, and he's supposed to rule in the Most High's absence. The Most High put him on this earth to rule and made him to have dominion over everything on this earth, inclusive of the woman. Women like to say you can't get here by without coming through her womb, right? She also experiences tremendous pain for that as a reminder of a punishment of disobeying the Most High. She undergoes a great deal of pain each time she brings forth birth. And some of them get these sedatives, these drugs to try and lessen the pain. But what I'm hearing is like a psycho-theological mechanism that really seems to function as an androgynous person. See, and what they do, when someone's involved in, androgyny, it's like whether they're homosexual, bisexual, they're able to express within themselves both sexual roles and identities. And this is what you keep trying to do. Well, see, in the sex act, they engage both as male and female. This is what androgyny is all about, right? It's equally. And this is what women keep trying to do. They try to make us their equal, but we're not. We're physically stronger. We have capacity to do many other things that she can't do. We're physically stronger. We could have baby after baby after baby with different women. The creator made us that way for a reason. It's a gift that you women keep trying to come along and deprive us of because of your emotions, and you don't have that capacity. Well, there's a reason that you don't have that capacity. But you keep trying to tap into this androgyny. Well, yeah, male and female. Yeah, we need both males and females, but the male is the dominant factor, and he's the leader. He's the head. What? Well, where's this noise coming from, man? This noise is coming. Marty, I guess. Or maybe it's her. Let me mute that. So now, the whole androgyny concept is what Satan does. He told the woman, think about this. He told the woman, your eyes will come open and you will be as God. Adam, the Ish, was already made as the Most High, because he was made in his image and likeness. And he was given dominion to rule the entire earth, just like the Most High. So he rules in the Most High's absence. But Eve wanted that same thing. So notice the tempter didn't go to Adam. He went to her. Why? Because she didn't have those same capacities. She wanted to be a God. See, man was made in the image and likeness of the Most High. The woman was made in the image and likeness of man. Man is the glory of the Most High, but woman is the glory of man. See, there's not an equality right there. The Most High didn't make it that way. It was that way for a reason. See, men, we're not equal, right? So, but when you bring in this androgyny and keep trying to say we're equal, equally as penetrators and penetrated, that's not the same. It's not the same. See, it's the hard and the soft. It's the law of nature. You have the hard, you have the soft. You have the hot, you have the cold. Man is the hard. The woman is the soft. She's supposed to be the soft. She's trying to be the hard. It's a reason that a woman's vajayjay is soft. She's the soft. It's a reason that a man's rod is hard. He's the hard. And thus, taste in some form or other, both physically and spiritually, this androgyny keeps coming in. But spiritually, they have the physical plane joined in opposites. See, we're opposites. Proven and experiencing that there is a distinction. But with androgyny, They're trying to tell you that there's no distinction between man and woman, that they're equal. But there's just distinctions according to the Most High. There's just distinctions. The Creator created distinctions. So androgyny that I keep hearing from you, because I'm listening to what you're saying, you keep saying the male and the female. But yeah, we're opposites. We're not the same. We have different purposes. Well, we have different purposes. The Creator made distinctions within us, man. So androgyny in various forms literally eradicate the distinction, which is why you keep bringing it in. That's what Satan does. He brings in androgyny, meaning, well, it's male and female. It's male and female. It's male. But yeah, there's distinctions in the male and females. And so what this androgyny does, it causes confusion of the human mindset with the divine, right? The distinction elevates the spiritual blending, right, of all things. All things has distinctions. That's what makes it great. That's what makes it so great. And this seems to be very, this is the logic that the Apostle Paul brings in the book of Romans 1. In 18 through 27. That's what Paul was talking about. But this modern secular androgyny is just more of a variant of pagan thinking. That's all it really is. This is why when the good brother Universal Sovereign Soul was saying, well, where's this coming from? You couldn't explain it because it's paganistic. It's paganistic. It's the spiritual mindset that the Apostle Paul speaks of in the book of Romans 1 and 18. And it's found in just about any world view that collapse. And this is what happens when you collapse the Creator. You say you believe in the Creator. You really don't. You collapse the Creator's distinction. See, the Creator created us distinctively different. Men and women are distinctively different. When you bring in androgyny, you're trying to make us the same, but we're not. And that's the essence of Satan's desire, is to try and make us equal. Because that goes against the divine patriarchy that the Most High set up in this earth. You cannot collapse this distinction without further collapsing all other distinctions that depend upon it. I digress. That's what I'm saying. We're not the same.
That's understood. I would like to say that sex is the joining of two energies to create another one. And that's the essence of how we all got here. I'm not trying to be in opposition to anything that you're saying relative to, you know, your perspective. What I'm saying is, internally, do you feel the nurturing
essence? It's not a perspective, it's a truth. So you go out, okay, you get pregnant, you go out, and then you get pregnant by another man. That's a distinction that we have that you don't have, but you're still missing it. I could go out and have sex with a woman a couple hours from now, have sex a couple hours later, and then again tonight and get all three pregnant. You do that. That's a distinction. That's not an equality. That's a power that man has that you don't have. That's a distinction that the Most High created for a reason.
I'm not in opposition to that. And I'm not saying that we're equal. What I'm saying is, relative to what
you're, when you talk androgyny, that's exactly what you're saying. Because androgyny, it says we're both, and if you go back to the conversation, you said it. You're always talking about the male and the female that's in both of us. But when a male is in his most high divine proper space, he's more masculine, and he's supposed to be more masculine than he is feminine. When a man's femininity overtakes his masculinity, you got a bitch. And you get what you get in society right now. You got women coming on like you that think you could be equivalent to a man when you're not. And the first damn thing will happen, if something get physical, you'll have to call another man to protect you. Or you're going to have to use a weapon or something that was created by a man. There's no equality here. People don't want to hear conversations like this, but they need to hear it, because you're not my equal. You're not my equal. You're not. We're not designed the same way. I'm designed a degree above you. I could do things that you can't do. Sure, you could do some things that I can't do, but I most likely wouldn't want to do those. I create things for you to live in. We create houses. We create the buildings. We create the internet. We create the weapons. You can't live without a man, but we can live without you until we're dead. But we need each other to reproduce, but stop trying to make yourself my equal because you're not. You're not. You couldn't survive without me. If you snatch away all the things that I, man, have created, women wouldn't be able to survive. It's been proven they can't survive out on their own. They can't do it. You look at my almost all the inventions in the world was created by men. We're creators. The Most High put that in us, and it's time that the world acknowledge that and recognize it, because that's the truth. That's the way it is. Most of what you've learned, you know where this philosophy coming from? You learned it from a man. You heard it from some woman. Even if you heard it from a woman, she got that from a man. Your universities and all of this created by men. They put women in them, but they was created by men, because men are the creators.
Well, I appreciate you for creating the platform, because this is a topic that needs to be discussed a little further without us having to devalue each other, because I'm not looking to be equal to anybody in particular. What I am looking to do is get to the truth of things. And it seems like in most of the doctrines that we do find, it's very little essence of the truth in it. It's always something that serves one person over another, and everybody else is just kind of left to the wolves. And it really seems that way as I'm looking at things.
Let's look at doctrines for a second, right? Just you and I, right? Just you and I. No, we're not dealing with the Bible. We're not dealing with nothing. Let's deal with truths. Huh? Let's deal with truths. All right. The house that you're living in, did an architect group of women get together and build that and build this? No, it was men. If you see a woman architect, where did she learn that from? She learned it from men. She learned that from men. These are facts. So in order for her to learn that, she had to learn that from a man. It was a man that was out there. You could go back to prehistoric times, man. Men back there in the so-called stone ages building stuff, carving things, making places for you to live in. Men was the protectors. Men was putting their lives on line, building spears and all of that to protect their women and children. Men did that. And it's been that way from the beginning. And you women need to learn to respect men. You need to start showing some damn appreciation, because you're disrespectful. You're not my equal. You couldn't even survive without us. That's a reality. You're not supposed to talk like this, but the hell we're on was politically correct. The truth is more important, and the truth doesn't need any apology. None of you women can survive without us. Without the things that men have produced in this world, you wouldn't be able to survive. And that's a fact. That's undisputable. Any woman, I don't care what position she's in, she's ascertained that position because a man allowed it. Because men run the world, and men go to war to conquer other men. And so the only reason that women have placed within these paradigms is because men allowed it. That's why you become spoils of war when one nation conquers another. You get raped or taken over, and the man decides he's going to do what the hell he want to do with you. And it's time that you women realize that, man. That's a fact. These are facts. Now, that's not dealing with religion or nothing. It's dealing with truth, man. That's pure truth right there. Now, if you want help with something, you got to call a man. You got to call a man.
I particularly wouldn't, but is that why the country is like it is now? Because it seems like, I don't know. I don't even know how to address
this. Don't like it, leave. See, I'm tired of that excuse right there, too. You wouldn't be able to produce the country like it is now. That's a fact. You wouldn't be able to build a damn thing because you would have done it. When you go to college and get these edumacations, let me ask you this. The first, who started the first university? Was it a woman or a man?
I don't know, but they probably didn't go to a university.
It was a man.
He didn't go to a university.
Yeah, he created it. I said who started it. Of course he didn't go.
Do you see what they look like now, though?
He created it. He created
especially the medical community. These people are learning what these people are teaching them, but they're not experiencing it in their real life. So then we have people creating
started by men. Yeah. I will even go back and take you and educate you on that. The first cooks were men. Men taught you to cook. How about that? Men taught you to cook. There's very few that you say you could actually do that a man didn't teach you or someone down your lineage. Men did it.
And
women
will
acknowledge that, and I take that as highly disrespectful because I'm a masculine dude, and I'm tired of women walking around like, you know what I mean, it don't stink or whatever, where everything that you're just about using on a daily basis was created by man.
And I appreciate it. I really do.
Because if you appreciate it, you will humble yourself and acknowledge it and stop trying to make yourself our equal. Because the fact is, if all men left and they just took those women that wanted to be submissive and like real women, you guys would just perish. You guys would just perish. All you women that want to be masculine and all of that, you would perish. You wouldn't be able to survive. That's a fact. When that generation die off, you guys would be done because you wouldn't have anyone building or none of that. All men gone. You live in a society by yourself. You go over there, you build that, you live off of that.
Well, I am thankful for the men. It does add the
icing. No, you're not. If you was, then women would show more appreciation. She wouldn't be keep trying. See, she think it's a war. When a man said he wants to be in his rightful place, like, listen, man, I'm the man. Listen, a man was created to be a head. The woman is part of the body. Am I saying that man should function without her? No. I'm saying she's not his equal. The man is the head. That's the way that the Most High made it. He's the head. She's part of the body. Without a head, you can't properly call a body into order. These are the facts, man. So this is why men have capacity to do many things that Eve may not be able to do. A man's strength is that way for a reason. A man can reproduce like that for a reason.
Okay, am I to understand that this is not a personal attack on me? Because I am one woman. Like, I'm talking to
women in general. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to, but the mindset of the modern woman is like yours. So I'm talking to each and every woman out there that has that particular mindset. Because that's the vast majority of women. Why do you think right now, I just stated, by 2030, 45% of women is going to be single with no children. What good is she in society? She's supposed to be an incubator for a man. The woman don't even understand her purpose of creation on this earth. You don't naturally have a purpose on this earth. You're going for what the world teaches you. Your primary purpose on this earth was to help the man, to be his incubator, to be his helpmeet. He reproduces life through you. That was your primary function and purpose on this earth. This world has moved away from it, and that's why the world is so messed up. People don't want to hear that, but that's the creator's design. And when you go against that design, you get the chaos. Don't blame it on men. Blame it on you for not wanting to play your part. Blame it on the evil patriarchals that's under Satan's authority that put women like you and other women out there in combat against her man. And she think is right, but more and more, you're seeing single women destroying children, rearing them alone and destroying them. Destroying them. They're destroyed. Look at the violence. Look at the mindset. Look, you know what they don't like to say in society? It's been proven that children that's raised by both parents do much better than children raised by a single woman. You can look these up yourself all over. Statistics show it. But you know what they don't push? Is that children that's raised by a single father do equally as good as children raised by both parents. Explain that one, sis. Explain that one.
The competence level of a lot of people in society would explain that, like, relatively. But what I'm trying to consider, when I came on here, to support you. As a man, not my man, but as a man, because I see what you're doing and and the work is phenomenal. So for me personally, you know, relative to you, I did come just like when we talked, what I was talking about with your book. I didn't say, hey, pay me to do the forward to your book. And then I said, well, are you going to use it? You said, of course, you wrote it. Why wouldn't I? But you don't even remember me. And so I'm like, well, maybe women aren't that important to you, but relative to the children.
See? Yeah, you caught that, right? You caught that, right? Now women are not important to me because...
I'm not saying that they're not, but like...
You know what I'm speaking?
That concept. Like, you don't even remember who I am, but I wrote the 4G book.
Yes, and that was years ago. Marty, how you in here? Matt Too Saucy. University, you caught that? You caught that, Matt Too Saucy?
Yeah.
Let me make this very clear, Secret Balance. I love women. I love real women. I love... See, here's the thing about me. I'm a spiritual man. I love women that are submissive women. A woman that's going to... A woman is going to stand by me and be the woman of the Most High. I'll die for that woman because that's my purpose of being here. I'll readily die for a woman that's going to stand by me and play her role like she was designed to be, to do, and my children. I'll lay my life down for that with no problem. But the thing that I see now, that's Satan's woman. I wouldn't die for her. I wouldn't even marry her. I wouldn't even marry her. I wouldn't even trust her because she's not herself anymore. That's fallen woman. That's fallen woman. And so, I mean, you see how you say you was for me? I listen to what people say. I don't just have foresight. I have insight. So I'm able to look into what people are really saying and get the, you know, the true meaning of what they're really saying. So while you say, well, you're for me, but you say, I don't like women, which is a lie. Listen, man, there's not a brother on this call that would not be attracted to a feminine, submissive woman. There's something about a feminine, submissive woman that a masculine man can't resist. It is in his nature to love that kind of woman. And women don't get that. That's all I'm really trying to say. But the women are so masculine, you can't talk to them like this because they take it as something weak. Huh? But when a woman comes on very masculine and you keep emphasizing about your shoulders, huh? It's masculine. It's a turnoff for masculine men. The polarities are off. In order for the polarities are on, if the man is masculine, then the more feminine the woman is, the better that relationship works out. The reason that relationships are not working in society, Eve is running her mouth. She's trying to be masculine. Like she's trying to drive a point home. Then when a man says, you know what, I'm done. She'll go and get a divorce, but the guy's done. And so sometimes the man doesn't want to deal with her so much. You know, a lot of fathers don't deal with their children because they don't want to deal with you. He don't want to deal with you. He goes through all types of intense pain to stay the hell away from you. So he stay away from his children. He said, I'll deal with them when they get older. And none of you could understand that because you're not in the position of a man. So the man said, okay, you want to raise him? You raise him. Because the rightful thing to do was to let them go with their father. Now, if you really love those children, it's been proven over again, over and over and over again, that the father is the most essential element in those children's life in the event of like a separation. The mother could be gone. The father will usually get another woman that could play that role of a mother. The same is not true. She'll get some man that's abusive. He might be a predator and so on and so forth. So the children develop all these problems, or she doesn't get a man at all. She's working all of the time. The children are rearing themselves. So we have, I could use the so-called black community as a catalyst. 80% of the children in the black community are raised by a single parent, the so-called black woman, Miss Know-It-All, right? That got it all together. But she's ruining the children's lives and then blame the man. oftentimes these fathers want to be in their life. She won't let him. The court system works with her because they want to destroy it. They want to destroy that family. So she goes and get on these whatever benefits, and the children suffer. And she tells the children's father, I mean the children, how no good their father are and how he abandoned him. But there's always two sides to every story. And so statistically, it's been proven that the so-called black men that they desecrate more than anyone, he spends more time with his children than any other man on the planet. But they don't tell that side of the story. They don't tell that side of the story. That inclusive of Europeans, the so-called black man spent more time with his children. So it's not about an attack on you. It's about men returning to being men and women returning to being women. And so this is why the so-called black community is so damn destroyed. The fathers are not in the homes. Gone. But you have to look into why. Did he just leave? I don't think he just left. There's a reason that he's gone. But the picture that they paint of him, oh, this man's no good. He's horrific. He's accustomed to abandoning his family, his children. Yeah, but where did he learn that at? Now, I could say that's an institution that was built off of white supremacy, and now they're trying to hide it and say, the so-called black man doesn't like his family. But you made him that way. You snatched families apart on the slave plantations. You put them on different, you snatched the family right away. And so you developed this thing that was nurtured into these men. For what? Over 300 years. And then say, why does he do that? Well, you engineered him to do that, but you don't want to assume responsibility. You see how that works? No one wants to talk about that.
Do you have a possible remedy for these things? Because I've experienced what you're speaking of.
I do. And you return to being a woman. You return to being submissive and a woman, which you don't want to do, but that's very hard for an androgynous sister like yourself. Both sexes, right? I mean, we both got the male and female. Yeah, we do. But the masculine man is going to always want that feminine woman. That's a woman that a man would die for. And women don't get that because they don't know how to be women anymore. Women haven't been taught. Women are not taught to be women. They want the bag. They want the bag. Well, see, and I can prove it. So a woman, when she's selecting a man, she's selecting a man based on, well, how much, what do you do for a living? Why is that one of the first questions? Man doesn't care about that. If he's well off, he doesn't care if you're working at McDonald's or not working at all. Why is it like that? See, she wants the benefits of a traditional woman, but she doesn't come as a traditional woman because a traditional woman had to be a virgin. That was a long time ago for most Eves. You see that? But she wants the benefits of the traditional woman.
So would me being a woman be to leave the platform? Because I'm like, I don't, like I'm lost for words here.
Oh, you what?
Okay.
Oh, you say you need to leave?
It's time for me to leave. Is this where I take my exit? Like, because I'm trying to see, like, you're not being a woman. So is that to not continue to speak on the issues that we're talking about? Or
You came to that analogy on your own. I can't recall saying secret balance, leave the platform. You must have established that analogy in secret.
No, I was asking a question because I was trying to see if we were in a open conversation or if I was getting attacked, because that's what it kind of felt like.
So for the third time, secret balance, you personalize it. And the question seemed as though it was rhetorical. Forgive me, sis. Forgive me. Forgive me, sis.
Well, I digress, and I will leave you all to your show. Thank you.
Shalom.
At least you had the courage to come on. You